Welcome to our fellowship on January 2nd, 2022, here at Tyndale Bible Church. We'll have a few announcements, not much again going on as we start the year, kind of the way we ended the year. So we'll have our prayer time, our hymn off camera, and then we'll come back with 1 Peter. And we're doing an introduction to 1 Peter, a synthetic overview of 1 Peter. And then we're going to have a special study led by Dr. Olander this morning. The Day of the Lord, and if anyone is going to teach that, he's the expert in the Day of the Lord, so wrote the book on it, outside of the Bible, so he probably knows more than anybody on the Day of the Lord outside of the Lord himself. And then we'll do our communion this morning, and then finish out with a second hymn. As far as announcements, today is communion and lunch on the grounds, and then catch anything on YouTube that you missed. Any other announcements, gentlemen? And then our cartoon, I saw this one, I think, a couple of months ago, so I've been kind of waiting to put it up here. But my New Year's resolution this year is to do the things I should have been doing last year. So for those who like New Year's resolutions, you know, go back and do the things we were supposed to be doing that last year. So. Yeah, the cartoons are always a little interesting how they draw their people. Okay, anything else? No. Okay, so with that, we'll go off air. We'll come back with our 1 Peter introduction.
Lord, thank you so much for this time you give us together to study your word, to grow and mature as your disciples, Lord, to grow closer to you. Our maturity will make us better witnesses to the world outside, Lord, and better disciples of yours and better brothers and sisters one to another, Lord. So please guide us in our time of study now that this might be accomplished. All for your greater glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. I have you there at the book, but we'll just get into the book later on. Before we consider the book, let's consider the author. Who wrote the book? As in keeping with the straightforward character of Peter, he makes clear his authorship in the first verse of the epistle. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, are the first words we read. Now, this perspective of the Apostle Peter being the author of this letter has been held throughout the Christian church from the second century onward. It was never questioned until liberal higher criticism emerged in the 19th century. At that point, certain Bible critics brought forth what they saw as a conflict. They cited this passage from the book of Acts. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled, and they realized that they had been with Jesus. The conflict arose in their minds because the epistle of 1 Peter exhibits an advanced literary style as well as a sophisticated vocabulary. And so they said, obviously, this letter couldn't have been written by this uneducated and untrained fisherman from Galilee. Well, there are at least two problems with their analysis and conclusion. The first has to do with the terms uneducated and untrained. These were statements made by the high priest of Israel and other members of the Sanhedrin and referred to the fact that neither Peter nor John had received rabbinic training. It did not mean that either of them were illiterate or uneducated in other ways. Second is the fact that this statement was made by the high priest in the Sanhedrin regarding Peter and John shortly after the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Peter then went forth to proclaim the truth of Jesus as Savior to the world over the course of the next 30 years. Since the primary language in the world at that point was Koine Greek, it follows that over 30 years, Peter would have developed a mastery of the language. And as for the sophistication of his vocabulary, this too could easily be the result of his being an accomplished public speaker rather than a literary scholar. Another example of Petrine authorship lies in the parallels between this epistle and his sermons in the book of Acts. Compare this afternoon, sometime later, compare 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, with Acts chapter 2, verse 23. Then compare 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 7 and 8 with Acts chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. And finally, compare 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 5 with Acts chapter 10, verse 42. We also note that in his commands to the elders in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2, Peter tells them to be shepherds, to shepherd the flock of God. The only other place in the New Testament where this word is used as a command is in the Gospel of John, chapter 21, verse 16, where our Lord Jesus told Peter, "Tend or shepherd my sheep." So the arguments of the critics against Peter as the author of this epistle are weak at best, especially when compared to the evidence and beliefs of the church throughout the past 2,000 years. As J. Ramsey Michael puts it, aside from the four Gospels and the letters of Paul, the external attestation for 1 Peter is as strong or stronger than that for any New Testament book. There is no evidence anywhere of controversy over its authorship or authority. And as for the author being the Apostle Peter, we should also note that there is not another man named Peter within the whole New Testament. So I think we can take Peter at his word. So then, we trust the scriptures as written and believe that the Apostle Peter wrote this first epistle bearing his name. Now, where did he write it from? Well, this is a major point of debate, one which will only be answered when we get to the other side of the veil. For the literal answer, we look to 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 13, which says this: "She who is in Babylon, elect together with you, greets you, and so does Mark, my son." Now, we believe in the literal, grammatical, historical method of Bible interpretation, which tells us that Peter was in Babylon when he wrote this. And there are many good dispensational theologians who believe this. One point that they make, which they believe supports this literal view, is the address order of the regions to which this letter is being sent, given in chapter 1, verse 1. The Apostle Peter says, "To the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia." If we look at where these nations were in the first century AD, we see this. Those who support the true Babylon position believe that the order of the countries noted here supports their view rather than the opposing view, which is that Peter is using the word Babylon as a code word for Rome. Here are the words of J. Vernon McGee on this subject. So consider the map while I read you this. Another very, very valid argument to indicate that Peter was in Babylon rather than Rome is based on the list of places which he addresses to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. All those places are in Asia Minor, the area which is called Turkey today. In listing them, he moves from east to west. This suggests that the writer was in the east at the time of writing. The natural and ordinary way to list geographical places is beginning from the point where you are. When I am in California and talk about going east, I would say that I am going through Arizona, Texas, and finally New York. It is normal to begin where I am and to name the places in sequence. Since Peter lists the places from east to west, it would seem logical that he was in literal Babylon. Now, all evidence that Peter was in Rome comes from church fathers who wrote about this starting over a century after Peter died. The first reference I found was in the work Against Heresies, written by Irenaeus in 190 AD. In it, he said that Matthew wrote his gospel while Peter and Paul were evangelizing in Rome and laying the foundation of the church. The next mention came from Tertullian in his work, The Demurrer Against the Heretics, written in 200 AD. In it he wrote, This is the way in which the apostolic churches transmit their lists, like the Church of the Smyrnians, which records that Polycarp was placed there by John, like the Church of the Romans, where Clement was ordained by Peter. So these works and many others attest to Peter being in Rome, but they all start over a century after Peter actually died. Three things should be considered regarding this evidence. First, there is no evidence whatsoever in the New Testament writings that Peter went to Rome. Second, if Peter was serving in Rome at the same time as the Apostle Paul, why doesn't Paul mention it at all in any of his epistles from that time period? Most of these guys write, as we'll see at the end of Peter, about who was with them there. You know, Timothy or somebody else, and I greet so-and-so, and they send their greetings. You'd think if Peter was there with them, he may have mentioned that Peter was there, you know. But there's no mention. And third, a certain amount of error can be found in the writings of the early church fathers. One time talking to an esteemed theologian decades ago about how he spent his summer, he said he had spent it reading the works of the early church fathers, which those of you who study at seminary know is like a set of books that's like, I think, about 22 volumes or so. And he had spent the summer reading that. And I said, what did you think after that? He said, I was amazed at how many errors they made in theology and in biblical thought. I said, okay. So there are errors that can be found in the writings of the early church fathers. Of course, this perspective that Babylon is actually a code word for Rome supports the Roman Catholic view very nicely, and so they are active in promoting it. However, many solid dispensational theologians also feel that the substantial amount of traditional support certifies Peter's presence in Rome. Those who support this view also say that there was no Jewish community in Babylon at that time, citing the first century Jewish historian Josephus. However, others say that there was a substantial community in Babylon at that time. Take, for example, Dr. Arnold Fruchtenbaum, who said this in his commentary on 1 Peter, referencing Peter in Israel after the death of Stephen when the persecution started. Dr. Fruchtenbaum says, later, Peter left the land to join those of the dispersion and arrived in Babylon, which in that day was the center of Judaism outside the land. So does Babylon actually mean Babylon here in 1 Peter chapter 5? Does Babylon actually mean Babylon here in 1 Peter in chapter 5? Well, I'll let you make your own decision. Don't worry, your choice will not affect the text or its meaning in any way. Peter is still writing to the same group of people, the ones cited on this map, who appear to be folks who weren't evangelized by the Apostle Paul as his route east moved toward the south of these territories, not the north. If you remember, if you take Paul's journeys and look, you'll see it going down. Here's Antioch and Tarsus, and there's Iconium and Lystra and Colossae and Ephesus, and then you would head over to Greece from there. Well, we don't see him go into those upper regions up there. So we think that this is the regions to where this letter is addressed. As for myself, I believe that Babylon means Babylon, since I have no biblical evidence to alter that view. Now, if you'd like to cover both sides of the argument, there are those who say that Peter was definitely in Babylon when he wrote this letter, but later he went to Rome. So there you go. You know, you can have your cake and eat it too. So then, when did the Apostle Peter write this letter? Well, first, let's just touch on one of the major themes of Peter's first letter, that of persecution. I bring that up because it will impact the possible dates for the writing of this letter. Some believe that the overall persecution referenced in his letter has to do with the persecution the Jews received in Israel following the martyrdom of Stephen, which is thought to have occurred sometimes in the mid-30s A.D. I've seen the range on this go from 33 AD to 36 AD. It was after his stoning that the persecution by the Romans against the Jews increased so as to cause the second diaspora for Israel. Since the apostle stayed in Israel for a portion of this persecution, it is thought that Peter wrote this letter to act as comfort and to strengthen those who had suffered the persecution and may be still suffering in these new locations. This would give this epistle an earlier date, which may be any time from the 40s up until the 60s, based on the tradition that Peter only lived until the mid to late 60s. However, those who believe that Peter didn't go to Babylon, but actually went to Rome, think that the persecution to which he is referring is the persecution the Jews and Christians faced in Rome, starting with Nero. Some date this persecution as starting at 64 AD, others at 67 AD. Since the countries to which this letter was addressed were all Roman colonies, the persecution would then have extended to them as well. So we have a range of possibly up to 20 some years over which this letter may have been written, depending on your perspective. As a side note, let me point out that if you go looking through commentaries to check out dates or do an analysis on this, you will find some estimates for writings as late as 81 AD during the reign of the Emperor Domitian. However, these late estimates are made by those who do not believe that Peter wrote this epistle. So they're not saying Peter lived beyond the mid-60s. They just don't believe that Peter actually wrote it. They think somebody else wrote it using his name. And so we don't consider those later dates valid because we believe that Peter actually wrote the epistle. Let's consider then to whom this letter was addressed. Well, Peter tells us this in verse 1. To the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God, the Father, in sanctification of the Spirit for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. So if we start backward with verse 2, we note that these are saved people. They are believers in Jesus Christ as their Savior. And verse 1 tells us that they are in various countries and that they got there because they are pilgrims of the dispersion. So let's consider what that means. The first Greek word translated in my New King James as pilgrims is parapedemos. And it means a resident foreigner, a sojourner, a pilgrim, a stranger. And that is who these people are. They have come from another land to these new lands, and they are now resident aliens living there. The second Greek word translated in my New King James as dispersion is diaspora. And it means dispersion, to be dispersed, to be scattered. But this word is much more than just another word used as an explanation. It is a word very connected to the Jewish people, as historically we speak of the exile of the Jews in the Old Testament to Babylon as being the diaspora. And here we have the Apostle Peter, whom the Apostle Paul confirmed as the apostle to the Jews in his letter to the Galatians, when he said, "When they saw that the gospel for the uncircumcised had been committed to me, as the gospel for the circumcised was to Peter, for he who worked effectively in Peter for the apostleship to the circumcised also worked effectively in me toward the Gentiles." So, knowing that Peter was in Jerusalem when the persecution of the Romans began, and knowing that he saw this great exodus of Jews from Israel at that time, and knowing that Peter is the chosen apostle to the circumcision, his use here of the term diaspora confirms that the audience here are indeed Jewish Christians who have sought to escape persecution by going to these other lands. I labored to make that point because, unfortunately, those Christians who believe in replacement theology, that the church has replaced Israel as God's chosen people, seek to interpret this first verse of Peter as referring to primarily the Gentile church. This especially holds true to those who believe that Peter was in Rome at this time, because the persecution there was primarily of the Gentile Christian church. Now, does this mean that there were no Gentiles in the churches in the lands of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia? No, I'm not saying that at all. However, the primary audience to whom the Apostle Peter is writing is the Messianic Jewish community in each of these countries. So then, what is the purpose of this epistle? Well, these were the Jewish Christians who had sat under Peter's teaching and that of the other apostles in Jerusalem before escaping for their lives. So Peter sought to continue teaching them by letter until the time he could hopefully be with them. These believers were trying to escape persecution from both the Romans and the Jews in Israel. However, if this letter was written during the 60s, then the persecution of the Christian church in general by the Romans had started, so they may have been suffering persecution in their newly chosen lands as well. Think of it. First you are persecuted from the Romans because you're a Jew. Then you become a believer in Jesus as your Messiah. Now you're persecuted by the Romans for being a Jew, and you're persecuted by the Romans and the Jews for being a Christian. So Peter is writing on two main subjects: how to handle persecution and how to continue to live an exemplary Christian life in the midst of your persecution. So with that in mind, let's start building an outline of 1 Peter. This isn't a long letter, so I'll be using a simple outline, actually the one from my New Scofield New King James Bible. With that as the basis, we will look at specifics within each section. Many of these you will find in the outline from the Bible Knowledge Commentary, if you use that. So first we start with the introduction, chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. As we've seen in our study so far, this covers Peter identifying himself as the author, telling us specifically where his audience for this letter is located, and qualifying them as being part of the elect, those chosen according to the foreknowledge of God as recipients of the saving blood of Christ through the grace and faith gifted to them by God. Our next section runs from chapter 1, verse 3, through chapter 2, verse 8. And in it, Peter speaks on Christian suffering and conduct in the light of complete salvation. In this section, Peter will speak about the new birth and the living hope these believers have received, which includes their future inheritance, as well as their present joy in how this was first proclaimed by the prophets in the past. Peter will then go on to speak of the Christian's conduct in light of the holiness of this new birth. He will speak on how they are to prepare themselves, the price that was paid by our Lord for their salvation, and how they were then purified by the Holy Spirit. He will then finish this section by speaking on how they are to act as purified believers in Jesus Christ. This will then bring us to the next section, which will run from chapter 2, verse 9, through chapter 4, verse 19. Where Peter will speak on the Christian life in view of the believer's position and the vicarious suffering of Christ. First, Peter will speak of these believers being a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, which some would attribute to the church in general, and others to the Jewish heritage of these believers specifically. We'll address that more fully during exegesis. Then, in light of this position, Peter will speak of expected conduct as witnesses to God's truth, as citizens, and as slaves. And as we begin chapter 3, he will then address new behavior expected in the family, specifically Christian conduct as wives and husbands. Following this, Peter will begin cautioning his audience for new persecution that will be coming. He will begin by teaching on compassionate conduct that they are to exhibit and on having a clear conscience no matter how they suffer because they are suffering for the sake of righteousness. That will carry us through chapter 3. In chapter 4 through verse 19, Peter will speak on how to endure suffering in the same manner as our Lord Jesus Christ. First, through having a Christ-like attitude. Pardon me. Second, through providing Christ-like service to others. And third, by exhibiting Christ-like faith. The next point of our outline will run from chapter 5, verse 1 through verse 9, where Peter will speak on Christian service in the light of the coming of Christ. Peter will begin with some specific instructions to elders, in which he will refer to them as elders, shepherds, and overseers, showing that all three titles refer to the same man. He will then give instructions specifically to younger people. The Greek adjective here is masculine, so some translations say young men, but many others just refer to younger people, believing that this is meant for all of the younger believers in these congregations. Finally, Peter will give a few verses of instruction to all the believers in these congregations in verses 8 and 9. Then we have Peter's conclusion in the last five verses of chapter 5. He begins with a benediction, a short blessing to end his letter. Then Peter speaks of those who are in Babylon with him, finally ending this letter by saying, "Greet one another with a kiss of love. Peace to you, all who are in Christ Jesus. Amen." And with that, we conclude our synthetic overview of the Apostle Peter's first letter. Next week, we will begin our verse-by-verse study of this book. Let us pray. Dear Lord, it's an exciting time to beginning this first letter from the Apostle Peter. There is so much in it that that speaks to us today, Lord. Definitely speaks to the church that is suffering persecution throughout the world. Thankfully, you have blessed us so that we have been spared from that in a major way, Lord, although it may be coming. So, Lord, let us read this and take it to heart, Lord, and let it show us, once again, reaffirming how we should be living every day in light of the great gift you have given us in your Son, our Lord Jesus. That we may bring glory to you in all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's take a break.